Oh, really? Seriously? You can't do that? You can't do better than that? We'll whip him into shape. Don't worry. So we'll just start her off with a softball question before we go. What projects do you guys got going on? Allie, do you want to talk about your music a little bit first?
Yeah. During this off time in the hiatus, my sister and I have been making some new music. It's been like 10 years since we've released an album, which is kind of insane because I'm not even really that old. and we're going to be releasing some new stuff in the summertime, which is awesome. I don't know. There'll be stuff in the future. It feels weird being like, and I'll be on this, and I'll be on that. So if you just check out my Instagram or my Twitter, it's just at Allie and AJ. You'll see updates on stuff that's coming out.
Malcolm?
Yeah, I'm actually working on the feature film next week with Lou Ferrigno. So it's like the DC family meeting the Marvel family. So I'm excited about that. And I've been doing a lot of directing over this hiatus. So, that's what's going on with me.
What have you been directing?
It's concept trailers and also pilot pitches for TV shows.
Sounds great. So, yeah. Sweet. Yeah. All right, so we're going ahead and get started. Who has a question? This is how this works for you two new people. Oh, he is, oh my God.
That's awesome.
Set phasers to sassy. All right, so.
Amazing.
May I? I'll show you how this works.
Oh,
that
yeah.
That thing right there.
Oh, yep.
This is a microphone, and we just bouncing around. You ready,
oh, that's
dude?
Cool.
Oh, that's awesome. I like that.
Watch two geeks do this inappropriately.
There you go.
That's amazing.
Hi.
Bar.
Oh, wow, this thing's on.
Whoa.
Okay, this question is for both of you. Yeah, both of you.
Yeah.
You get the script for the next episode. You find out your character is going to be turned into a zombie. How do you feel?
You know, I was shocked. I had no idea that was going what? Well, no, I don't turn into a zombie. When I found out about zombies, are you asking me?
It's a hypothetical.
Oh, hypothetical.
Scenario. Yeah. You just found out your character's going to be a zombie. How do you feel?
Like, I answered the question like I was about to give a spoiler or something like that. Clive's going to be a zombie. Did I say that? you know what? I always say Clive just would not make a good zombie. I don't even know how I would rock that look, honestly. I mean, I just don't know. I just don't know. I always say. I mean,
you look dope.
He's gonna
with some little white, you know, streak going through.
The white streak. I think Clive's gonna look ashy. I don't know if he. I don't know. He got to keep a lot of lotion on standby. I don't know. I don't know. But if that happens, I think Clive would embrace it. He would have to definitely carry a bunch of lotion around, and I think he will go into zombie mode more often every time he looks at his face. I mean, he would be so upset with it. So yeah.
Same with Peyton?
Yeah.
I have to say, I think I would be a little bummed because now I'm almost kind of stoked that I've been human this whole time. Like, you know, me and Malcolm have been holding down the fort with being human. Also, Ravi. So I don't know. Like, now I'm kind of almost proud to be a human. Even though in the very beginning of the show, I was really anxious and excited to become a zombie. But now I'm just kind of like, it's okay. It's cool to be human. It's fine. And if it happens, I think I would be into it, but I think I might be kind of slightly disappointed. If that makes any sense.
Yeah, next question. All right, somebody throw it. There you go.
All right. Hey, guys.
Yeah,
I had a question for both of you.
Yeah.
Malcolm, when you found out that Liv was a zombie, Clive struggled with it immediately.
Yeah.
How do you think he's going to adjust to that in the coming season? And with Peyton, what do you think was the biggest thing with her struggling understanding it when she went away, when she first found out about it?
Well, I think the way the season ended last year was Clive still didn't have enough time to kind of process what was going on. I mean, he just found out that Major's a zombie, Liv's a zombie, his boss was a zombie, and he's also broke up with his girlfriend. So I think there's a whole lot to process. But knowing Clive and the fact that he's survived this zombie attack at Max Rager, I think he's going to work with it. I think he always focuses on the bigger picture. I always say he's a one track minded kind of guy, you know. So it's about, we need to stop this thing from becoming bigger, and we can't have the world exposed to what has happened in Max Rager. So I think he's going to join Team Z and join the fight to kind of contain this thing.
I think the hardest part for Peyton when she found out about the news was seeing how hard it was for Liv to trust her. And I think Peyton, you know, wanted her to feel like she really truly is safe with this kind of information and that she would never betray her. But I think that Liv was in a moment in her life that was so hard for her to try to be herself, that it was impossible for her to even be transparent with her best friend, who she has shared a lot of moments with. So I think the hardest part for Peyton was her seeing that, okay, her friend is in this place where she's been put in danger, and you know, she needs to be kept a secret from the rest of society. And I think that was really hard for her to wrap her mind around.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Cool, next question.
Oh.
Teach you to sleep.
Hello.
Hi.
So I follow all of you guys on Instagram, and you, like, it's hilarious, because it's obvious you all get along, and you're all geeks, and I'm interested in what you guys geek out about in your spare time.
Oh, I like that. That's a good question. You know, we really do get along, which is so great, because you obviously, you know, meet these people, they're strangers at first, and then they become your extended family. And I do think it's something that you can really see on screen. So we all are really lucky that we have fun on the show, on and off set, and, you know, we're always commenting on each other's pictures and making fun of each other, as you've probably seen. What do I geek out about? I have to say I geek out about, like, nostalgic things from my childhood, like Limited 2, like Thumbelina, like who I see in the back. Things like Sailor Moon, Powerpuff Girls.
I'm Blossom.
Okay, that's me. So this might be difficult here. I'm not really sure. We can have two Blossoms. That's cool.
Yeah,
okay.
We're cool. Okay.
I got really excited when they relaunched Powerpuff Girls. Yeah, which was awesome. Yeah, I'm just kind of nostalgic about all things late 90s, early 2000s. So it's a pretty large group of things. But in general, yeah, that's kind of my stuff that I geek out on. And books. I'm a huge reader. I'm a huge bookworm.
What's your favorite book?
My favorite book?
Yeah.
Ooh. I'd say one of my favorite authors would be Henry Miller. Okay. That's one of my faves.
Yeah. Oh man. This is a long list. I try to keep it short.
It's
though.
Hard.
I used to be a hardcore gamer, like hardcore, and used to be. Yeah, Raul's trying to bring me back.
He's trying to get you back.
I'm like, I retired the joystick, but there's muscle memory. Like for example, I grew up playing Street Fighter 2 and Mortal Kombat, so. I don't know if you know this, but on a rap party for this season, they had an old Street Fighter 2 arcade game.
Oh, I didn't know that. Yeah. I must have laughed before you guys. Did you play it there?
Well, I hadn't played in years. I'm just like, hey, Michael, we heard you used to play. I'm like, yeah, back in the day, you know, I don't really play anymore. I got on the game. I think I went 58-0.
What?
Whoa. Yeah. 58.
Wait, and how long had it been?
Muscle memory.
How long had it been since you'd played?
Years.
Like 10 years?
Years. I mean, I'm just like,
I don't know what's happening. Your
played,
body was just like reacting.
I played so much as a kid. I just,
That's nuts.
Yeah. And I pick annoying characters to play with that people hate to lose by, like Dawson. People hate to lose with you know, get beaten by Dawson. But if I'm pretty good with Dawson. And Chun-Li, you know, when the competition is a little bit higher than is Chun-Li. And TV shows, one of my favorite TV shows of all time is 24. Yeah. I was a hardcore 24 fan. Yeah.
So is Street Fighter your favorite game?
It is my favorite game. My favorite game, absolutely. Yeah.
Okay, next question. Good.
Yeah, either way.
I can't promise.
Just try it.
Oh, nice catch.
I was wondering, what are the brains made out of on the show, and have you guys ever just eaten them?
I have never eaten them. Have you ever eaten them?
I did, season one.
Just to try it?
No, well, they put it on that pizza, and I couldn't eat pizza for like 5 months afterwards.
Because you were having like some serious trauma from that. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, yeah. It's agar-agar.
Yeah, it's like a gelatin. Uh-huh.
Oh. And you know what? When you eat it by itself, it's fine. It's yeah. Tolerable.
It just got a weird texture, kind of.
When you put it on anything you love, you will not love it anymore.
Well,
you got to stay away from it for a few months.
I remember. I forget what episode it was exactly. I think it was season two. Yeah. No, maybe they all literally now at this point they all just meld together. But, yeah, Rose had to eat like a BLT. It was like a brain lettuce tomato sandwich. And it was like she was even kind of like gagging while she was having to eat it. And I was just like, oh, I'm so glad that I'm not a zombie in the show because I would not be doing well with this. And it kind of ruined BLTs for me just for like a couple weeks. Just thinking of it, I didn't even taste it. I was just looking at it and smelling it. And that was enough for me. So
thank you.
You're welcome.
Yep. Just throw it. Come on.
Ooh, man. Dang.
You guys are being really sheepish with this.
Oh!
Whoa! Nice!
All right!
Good job.
That's awesome. That was close.
That was good.
I got contract.
I have a two-part question about what goes on behind the scenes. Are there any pranks that you all play on each other? What's your favorite one? And I guess it's three parts. Do you have any routines or rituals that you prep yourself in with to get into the role and mindset of Detective Babineaux and Peyton the lawyer?
Well, behind the scenes, there's a lot of waiting, which most people might not know about. And when you bring like friends or family on set and they're all excited and think like, this is cool, they end up just spending most of the day like waiting around. I mean, they obviously are watching the scenes happen, but you know, we're changing like direction of where we're shooting, where we're placing the camera. We also do the scene like tons of times. It's not like we just do it once and then we move on. We literally do the scene 30, 40 times. Especially if it's a stunt scene, then the day, you know, is even longer because there's, you know, certain stunt moves that need to happen and the camera has to be in the perfect place. Sometimes we'll forget our lines, so we have to redo it. So yeah, that's kind of, the day is, you know, usually started at an early time, especially on a Monday. That's when everybody's in at like 5 a.m., something like that. You know, we have hair and makeup and wardrobe and costumes. There's a bunch of like snacks and stuff on set, which you kind of have to stay away from sometimes because it's really tempting and they have a lot of candy and me and Malcolm love candy.
Oh,
so
I'm about to have a piece of candy right now.
Exactly. I just had a Milky Way like 10 minutes ago. So that's kind of what our day, I guess, entails. That and a lot of like running lines with each other back and forth, even prepping for the next day, which we'll be shooting for, and therefore we need to memorize our lines the day before.
Yeah. Well, I know for me, Clive wears the tightest pants, pair of pants.
Known to mankind.
Known to mankind. So it takes about 15 minutes to get into those pants.
That's your prep? That's how you get into the role?
That's how I get into the role. Yeah. No, it's, I have this thing that always is this speech I learned in theater school. I don't know if you guys heard it. We are the music makers. We are the dreamers of dreams, wandering by lone sea breakers and sitting by desolate streams, world losers and world forsakers on who the pale. You know, that whole speech, I do that full voice.
Every day?
Every day.
I didn't know that.
Every day.
It's not like I'm listening in the trailer, you know?
Yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah, Rose is like, who are you talking to so loudly? I'm like,
that's so funny.
Saying the same thing. Yeah, but that's one of that became my ritual, like, in college. And I carried it with me to this day.
So do you do it just the once in the morning or what?
Just the once.
Arrive, because Jack Lemmon would say it's magic time. Every time.
Magic time.
Really?
Yeah, absolutely. That's
cool.
Magic time. Yeah.
Once I'm in those tight pants, once I squeeze into those pants and that tight shirt, and I got mobility,
It's magic time.
It's magic time.
That's funny.
All right.
Yeah, I don't think I have like a massive ritual that I do before, but a big part of it, it really is the wardrobe, I think. Like being in full wardrobe and hair and makeup, you kind of do, it's almost like putting on like a Superman mask or something, or I guess Superman doesn't have a mask, but you get it. Like a superhero mask.
Oh, absolutely.
Right,
it's
you know?
It's like transforming.
Yeah,
yeah,
it's like
absolutely.
Transforming. It's like your cape or something. So that really, I think, is what helps me is getting into the tight lawyer skirt and the... and the black heels.
All right, next question. Where's it at? Did you already get it? Are we ready? Are you throwing it?
Oh, sorry. Oh, okay.
I've got a question. How is Peyton going to react to Robbie becoming a zombie, if he becomes a zombie?
You know, if he becomes a zombie, I think it would definitely test the relationship. I think it would also make it a lot harder for them to have a casual romance on the side for fear of her getting turned into a zombie. But, you know, I think that she at least would be prepared more than she would have been before because she, you know, already has two friends that are zombies between Major and Liv. But yeah, it would be interesting, actually. It'd be really interesting to see that character turn, especially because he's such an expert at everything zombie and is trying to find the cure.
Yeah. Could we expect to see more interactions between Peyton and Clive in the coming season?
That's a good question.
Yeah, we do.
I mean,
oh, we have a fun one. We have.
Oh, yeah, we do. We do.
We have a...
We both just like had a moment. We're like, yeah.
Remember that?
Yeah. It's actually, I think that's the best episode of this season.
That was
what episode is that? Do you know?
I think 6 or 7.
Okay. So it's like right in middle of the season, basically, yeah, is one of our favorite episodes. Even the rest of the cast, I think, agrees that it was one of our best.
One of our best ones. Yeah, I think we tweeted right afterwards saying this had to be the best.
This was the best day on set.
The best day on set.
Yeah, it was great. Ever. We didn't really have anything for season. Like, I really, truly don't think we even had one scene, did we? One? Uh-huh. You probably know more than we would. To be honest. Oh, okay, good.
So that was season two.
That was season two. Oh, okay, so one, though, I don't know. Do we?
Season,
oh, good. Oh.
It's coming.
No, we probably did, but I mean, literally to the point where, like, maybe we didn't talk to each other. Like, we were in the same scene, but not really interacting.
Not interacting.
Because I feel like the first season I had most of my stuff with Liv and Major, really.
Mm-hmm.
And then everybody else I didn't really interact with. But this season we do. We have some stuff. And some stuff with some cases that cross over that I'm handling, they're handling as the two of them.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Next question.
Do you or any of the other cast play pranks on each other on set?
Kind of. I mean, I'm not really a prankster. It's just not my thing. But not that I'm against it. But I would say Rob and Raul, right?
Yeah.
More
Rob got to be.
Rob's by far
Rob
the
Buckley
most prankster.
He's the most prankster. He's one of the funniest people you can ever meet. I think the first, I don't know if he's going to like me saying this, but I don't know. But it was season one, and it's the scene where it was our first scene, one of our first scenes together. But he has to walk in, I think, Julian. He just shot Julian in the chest, and he's like, Clive, I shot the guy upstairs. Come and see. So anyway, all that is shot on the soundstage, so... Buckley is standing right in front of me, and on action, Buckley would fart on cue. And so I would have to walk through. I have to walk through the...
Malcolm. Are you seeing somebody for it, like to help you with the...
Listen,
after?
I'm walking in with a screw face in that scene, and I'm reacting to... I'm like... And the director's looking at me like, Malcolm, keep that expression when you walk in. We like that. You're doubtful. You know, I'm getting from, and don't have any.
That's funny.
You know, yeah, I'm trying not to. I'm dying on the inside. My lungs. I'm
like, you're literally not breathing.
I'm trying not to open my mouth here. But he kept setting that up, and he is in tears. I mean, he is just rolling throughout the entire thing, and he kept doing it every time, right on action. So walking through a Rob Buckley fart cloud.
Yeah, there you go. So he's our prankster on set. Yeah.
Okay, next question. Where we got? Where we at? There we are. Ooh.
What is the best advice that you've ever been given?
Best advice? I think what's really important to hold on to in life in general, but especially in this business, is people that you can trust and people that have your best interest. I think it's really important, whether it's a family member or a best friend or an aunt or uncle or mentor, to have someone in your life that you can go to when you're down, when you need advice, when you need someone to cheer you up, that you can really truly trust. And I think it's more about the quality of person, not quantity. You know, having 100 friends, you know, doesn't really mean anything if you can't really count on them when you need them most. I also think being yourself is so important, especially nowadays when, you know, I think people can so easily be put in a box. Or be told that, you know, they're weird or different or strange or not normal. And I think that all of those things are wonderful. I think those are all great things that should be embraced. So I think really truly being yourself and letting your freak flag fly,
Absolutely.
Know, is like a mega positive. And is really, I think, super fulfilling as a person to be able to be yourself.
Everything you said.
I mean, yeah.
I mean, pretty much. I know I used to always hear, I held on to as a kid, I always just used to say, a teacher once told me, you know, have less fear to be fearless. Mm. And that stuck with me as a kid. You know, I'm like, I remember, you know, I was a shy kid, this shy kid with a terrible stutter and stammer, and I stammered, and people who wanted to be an actor. You know, and they was like, well, you can't even speak. How are you going to be an actor speaking? And then I remembered, now I'm going to learn a monologue. I'm going to get in front of people, and I'm going to do it. And I did it, and it was like the first time in my life where there was no stuttering, no stammering. Everything went away when I gave that particular speech. And I had no idea it was going to lead to a career in acting. I just did it for fun. I did it as a release. I did it because I was afraid of it. And just holding on to that mantra of having less fear to be fearless, and I kind of that kind of applied to so many things in life outside of acting.
Good question. Next question, please, right there in the front.
What do you think Blaine's going to do in the next season?
Well, we do know.
Well, I was about to say they know. Like, what can you tell us?
What can you tell us?
Gosh, what can you tell?
Malcolm, what can we tell them?
Man, what can we tell?
Well, I can tell you that there's a love triangle that's happening between Peyton and Ravi and Blaine. So that still keeps going. We don't know how long it goes till or for, but that love triangle still is happening this new season when we premiere April 4th. Little plug there for all of you guys that don't know that we're coming back.
Is that it? Okay. Next question. What we got? We got a bunch of people over here, so let's heave it that way. This way. There you go.
That's a good arm. That's a good arm. And accuracy.
Nice.
Good throw. And I just have a quick question. If you had to pick any other CW show to cross over with your own, which one would you pick?
Oh, I know.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah.
I'm trying to think. See, I'm just going more with like, what's the realistic show that actually really could truly work? I mean, Supernatural would kind of work. You know what I mean? Because like, they would not be shocked that they're zombies. They'd be like, oh yeah, okay, cool. Yeah, we can handle this.
Yeah, exactly.
You know what I mean?
Exactly.
And I feel like they could like team up with you and Liv, the two of them.
As long as they don't go after Liv, but we've been
right, right,
exactly.
About to say.
Like, they may kill
like,
your
we're
main
not
character.
Supposed to get rid of her. Like, don't kill her. Like, she's cool. She's good. I think Supernatural, Maybe Jane the Virgin, that might be kind of interesting. I don't know, you know, just...
Yeah, why not?
Like zombies, hey, like babies, virgins, you just, you know, you get it all in one show. Yeah, I think those two kind of, I think.
Yeah, yeah, I always think Supernatural would be like a
Supernatural
nice,
is the one that I think.
Yeah, I think
and they
be
shoot
a nice
in Vancouver where we shoot.
They shoot in Vancouver, exactly,
so it'd be easy.
Right down the block.
Exactly, yeah. Oh, yeah, that's cool. There you go.
It is.
Done.
You just gave away your idea.
Yeah.
We're going to just put
just,
you
in right, just right now. They're going to show up in the writer's room going, hey, all right. Our next question. Where's it at?
All right. Oh, wow.
You okay? which of the different personalities live been through was the hardest to act with without cracking up?
I think this was our favorite episode. We can say it, right? We've talked about it, haven't we? I have. I mean, I think so. Well, I'm just going to say it.
Yeah.
Does it matter
go
at
ahead.
This point? I mean, the show is going to premiere in a month anyway.
Yeah, exactly.
We
yeah.
won't tell anybody, right, folks? Right? Yeah. None of this is going on the YouTube.
There you go. I think the favorite one was when she is on a
Dungeon Master.
Master. It's pretty funny. And there's, that's probably the one that we also had the most like outtakes of because she kept laughing.
Yeah.
And then we kept laughing and it just got ridiculous, but it was really funny.
Yeah, they do a gag reel every year. It's like
it was like half the gag reel
is from that episode.
Yeah.
Of us just breaking.
Yeah.
Also, Rob Buckley does a brain that's hilarious.
Oh, yeah,
this year,
that's right.
Too, that had us cracking up a lot too. So yeah. You'll see. Yeah.
Cool. Right over here and in the back. You pick, dude. Oh, okay.
What is your favorite line in iZombie?
Clive is alive.
Clive is alive.
Hasta la vista, Mima, and Clive is alive.
I think my favorite line is your line from the, we're really just plugging this Dungeons and Dragons episode.
Oh, yeah.
Is when you say, where's the, what is it? You go, where's the dang?
The lark?
What is it? Lich.
The lich.
He goes, where's the dang lich? And it just made us laugh. That's my favorite line. But you guys haven't seen it yet, but you will see.
Is it? Yeah.
Where's the dang lich?
Where's the lich?
All right.
Thumbelina
yeah.
in the back?
Yeah, Thumbelina.
Hi, thank you for recognizing me. I was really worried. You're 2 out of 5. Then.
No, I love it so much. My sister actually was Thumbelina last year, I think, for Halloween. But I think she's going to be disappointed because you, I think, are better.
If you look closely, this is my first time sewing and it's not that
No,
great.
It looks great.
Great job.
Yeah, really good.
All right. Gosh, question. Okay, so we talked about what you liked in the past that Liv was. If you could pick a archetype character that she had to eat the brain of that you think would be the most hilarious or most interesting, what kind of person would you have her eat the brain of?
Gosh, I don't know. You know, she's never eaten the brain of like a stand-up comedian.
Oh, and Rose would.
That would be pretty
would
funny.
That. She'll be so good.
I think that would be really good. I also think it would be funny if she could. You know, Rose is from New Zealand, so she's a Kiwi. So if she ate the brain of someone who's from New Zealand, it would be pretty funny because she has a New Zealand accent, which you would never really know if you watch the show. So yeah, either one of those, I think she would be great on.
Yeah, I try to pitch. We did the singer one because Rose could sing. Rose got a great voice, so we wanted her to. It was like to hear her sing, and I think I want her to. A woman who loves cat, a cat
oh,
lady.
Oh, cat lady, because she hates cats. Like, is terrified. I mean, I kind of am too, so we bond on, like, our dislike for cats, no offense. I'm really allergic, and I'm kind of terrified of them. Yeah. So that would be amazing.
That would be hilarious.
Like, she just has, like, 100 cats all over her.
That'd be great.
It's kind of morbid, but I think it'd be funny if she ate Clive's brain.
Oh.
Then that means
but
I'll
then
be
he's
dead.
I said morbid.
Next question. Thank you.
oh, sorry. So my question is, what was that moment when you thought, I'm going to be an actor or actress? I mean, were you washing dishes and decided, hey, I want to be an actress or and
that
shower.
That moment, that click moment.
Wow, yeah. I don't know if there was like a specific moment, at least for me. I think it was a matter of, this is something that is really fun that I love to do. And, you know, if I can continue doing this and have a great time, then maybe I can make this a job. And then it eventually happened. But I don't know if I, at like 10 years old, I was like, I'm going to be an actor. I think it just kind of happened. I mean, obviously my parents knew that I wanted to get into this industry. And I like begged them. And I said, like, I'll pay for like photos and whatever. And they're just like, okay, like, we'll let you do this. And I'm sure it'll be a fun, like, thing you guys can do on the weekend, and it'll never amount to anything. But then I guess it did, so then I just kept doing it. But I don't know. I think starting from a place where it's a genuine love for the art is always really important, I think, in anything that you do, whether it's, you know, painting, sewing, cosplay, whatever it may be. I think if it comes from a place where you truly love it and it makes you happy, then that's great. That's a great start.
Yeah, I think for me it was probably in high school. This monologue from a play called Medal of Honor Rag by Tom Cole, and I remember learning the piece, and I didn't really want. I did acting for fun. Me and my friends did it, so it was a release. But no one was trying to do that for a living. You know, I wanted to be a baseball player or a scientist, so I was working on that. But then I did this piece because we had to do it, and I remember doing it, and then it was just like an out of body experience. You know, I was so invested in it, and then looked up, and everybody's like, yeah.
You're like, nice, I like this.
And, yeah, and then it was one of those things, and just the feedback, and then I fell in love with connecting. I learned so much from that character. So it was also that reaction and getting lost and having that experience to bring something to life that was once just living on a page and actually bringing it to life in front of a lot of people. And it just became addicting.
Thank you.
Okay. Next question. Where is our microphone? All right. Yeah, let's throw it back up here. And a miss.
What's your biggest inspiration? Like, who inspired you to do this?
You go first.
Who inspired me? You know, actually, my two big inspirations coming up, like I said, I had, when I talk about my speech issues come out, apparently. But it was James Earl Jones and Tony Randall. They had speech impediments coming up, and so I kept those two actors' faces on my walls. I was a basketball fan, but there wasn't Michael Jordan or John Starks being from New York. I was a big Knicks fan, or Patrick Ewing. I had James Earl Jones and Tony Randolph from The Odd Couple, and I'm like, they overcame their speaking impediments, and I can overcome mine. And they were huge inspirations for me. So I was also obviously a big Star Wars fan and big Odd Couple fan. And I followed, it was random. This random kid and little kid in Brooklyn, you know, favorite actors, James Earl Jones and Tony Randall. And so those two guys and their journeys, they became inspirations for me.
I think I would say my sister, because she is 2 years younger than me, but she started acting professionally before I did. I had braces, I was super gangly and long arms and limbs, and I wasn't booking for a really long time. Like, I would go to my acting class and I'd study really hard and I would go into a bunch of auditions and I just wouldn't book. And I remember her working a lot when I was younger and really looking up to her and how hard she worked at such a young age. You know, she was like on TV shows when she was like 10 years old. I think I'd say my sister, AJ, even though she's younger, you can still awesome. Look up to someone even, you know, despite their age.
Absolutely.
All right. There we go.
Hi. Allie, I've been a big fan of you ever since Disney Channel. You were amazing on Phil of the Future.
Oh, thanks.
My question is, what episode was the best one for each of you to film?
This past season? You know, our finale was really fun. It was interesting, too, because we kind of shot it in two pieces because we ended up going away for Christmas break and then coming back in the new year. I think we had a great time just because, you know, we were able to resolve some storylines this year that were kind of left hanging from last year. So I think it was just fun for us as a cast to do this last episode all together and be in really good spirits.
Yeah, I would say the same. It was also...
And the Dungeons and Dragons episode.
Dungeons and Dragons episode. Those, yeah.
My personal favorite episode would have to be where she eats the brain of a college frat boy.
Oh, yeah. That is a great one.
Yeah, zombie bro.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
All right. Right over here. That'll work, too. That's
Hi,
okay.
How are you guys?
Hi.
How you doing?
Okay, being a Kiwi in America, I have a lot of people mimicking me. I'm wondering, do you mimic Rose a lot? And how are your Kiwi accents now?
Ooh, ours are not great. You know, who tries to do Rose and it's bad?
Anders.
Anders.
But Anders impersonates everybody. It's Anders.
Yeah, yeah.
And Roe does a...
Rose, yeah.
We kind of bastardize it. We do it bad on purpose.
I don't know. It's almost more really like I can hear it. Like, if I was just silent, I could hear her voice in my head. But I'm not as good at mimicking it then. I don't know. I'd have to be doing it for a role, I think, to be actually good at it. But yeah, she just goes right in and out of it. It's pretty funny.
Yeah, yeah. It's I can't do it. It's just I can't do a Rose impersonation. Okay. I did one at Comic-Con, but it was horrible. It was just like, hey,
we'll never do it again.
She calls me Mackie G. So I did a Mackie G. Give me, let's go get some coffee, something like that. But I don't do an impersonation of her.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Right over here or right over there.
All right, this is going to be a weird question. So this is a hypothetical question for both of you.
How weird. I've got like two jobs, dude. How weird. Go ahead.
So we know that Liv has officially killed someone, and in season one she attempted to kill Blaine whenever they first started and then backed out of it. So now that she's officially killed someone, I know that probably takes an effect on her and her role and stuff like that. So... how do you guys think she would react if she was to eat a brain similar to Blaine's and ended up taking more personality actually into her actual mind and not the brain that she eats and ends up becoming sort of similar to the way Blaine acts now?
Oh gosh.
Kind of like having two Blaines.
Yeah.
Blame brain.
Yeah, I think it would be, I think it would be hard for us because she wouldn't be the same Liv ultimately. And she'd be making decisions based on probably money and power.
Yeah, exactly.
I think that would suck. It'd probably not be fun.
I mean, Blaine is also charming too. It would be... They would have to roll. Clive would have to roll with it. He would say, "Listen, as long as you focusing on solve a case,
true.
Let's figure out how to use those attributes for that." And
as long as she still wanted to do good, it would be
to
okay.
Do good.
If
I'm
she
sure.
wanted to turn to the bad side, then I think it'd be more of an issue.
Yeah, and I'm sure Clive will make a lot of faces to her behavior as usual. But you know, as long as it ended up in him and solving a case, I think he would just have to roll with it.
Well, what I was actually meaning was like if she, after she ate the next brain, some of that personality trading still stayed with her.
It stayed with her. It was like residue.
Yeah.
Gosh. It would be hard to decipher. Yeah, exactly. Like who exactly she is at that point because she could be like 50 different people.
Well, I tell you what, that she'll have a huge crush on Peyton because... You know, you may have to deal with that kind of
residue. That would be interesting.
And she's your roommate, and she's knocking on your door like
at midnight.
At midnight.
Funny.
Like, hey, Peyton.
Want to have a sleepover?
We've got time for just a couple more. So, who wants it next? Who's got a question and hasn't asked it yet? All right, we got one there, and then one over there. This lady, go ahead.
Being on set with all those people and everything. I'm sure you've had embarrassing moments and stuff. What's your most embarrassing moment on set?
Oh, most embarrassing moment. Most
guys, there gotta be something with those tight pants. I'm trying to figure most embarrassing moment. Anybody go put the Jeopardy music on right now?
Yeah, no. You know, I don't think I've had, like, at least I don't feel like I've had an embarrassing moment on the iZombie set, but I've had an embarrassing moments on other sets, which I think would come more from, and, you know, it's unfortunate, but it definitely happens, a director kind of talking down to you or to another actor in front of crew, which is embarrassing and, you know, kind of unprofessional. That is like the worst. And it's even worse if it's not directed at you and it's directed at someone else and you can tell that they're really embarrassed and that other people are watching. That is like so not cool. That's definitely happened to me, unfortunately, on other jobs, but not on iZombie, thankfully.
I can speak on another job. There was a movie that I did called Crazy on the Outside with Tim Allen. And so when I was casting a role, I was cast for this. It was like these two guys who had this back and forth banter. The other guy was played by John Grise, and the character name was Edgar. So I remember talking to meeting John Grise, and I was a big, he played Uncle Rico in Napoleon Dynamite, and I was a huge fan of his and stuff. And I'm like, hey, man, yeah, I'm looking forward to playing Edgar. He goes, I'm looking forward to playing Edgar. So I'm like, I thought this was like a joke, how he joked or something. And I'm like, yeah, Edgar's going to be fun. Yeah, Edgar's going to be great. And I'm like, yeah, that's weird humor, but I guess he's like, he likes saying he's going to play my character.
Wait, what?
I'm dead serious. We get on set, and then what happened is they have both cast us as the same.
Stop.
The paperwork was exactly the same. So I'm like, hold on, why are you?
You guys
like,
both start to say like, at the same time?
This joke is getting old now. Like, I mean, I'm like, he's like, I'm playing Edgar. He goes, yeah, I'm playing Edgar. And it got a little, I'm like, hold on, can we, all jokes like, aside, real? What character are you playing? He goes, I'm playing Edgar. I'm like, they got me playing Edgar too. And then.
So what happened? Did they have to switch one of you guys to the other?
Apparently the paperwork, I was supposed to play the other character. And I didn't learn any lines. I did not work on that other character, so literally it's like a half an hour before shooting.
No.
And I have to figure this out on the spot. So it wasn't my fault, but I was super embarrassed anyway, because I'm sitting here like, you know, there's a process, you know, before and performing in front of all these people.
That would be embarrassing.
And I worked on the other character completely. And but
he keeps saying Edgar on set throughout the movie. He's like,
oh yeah, it became a big deal playing Edgar. I'm like, yeah, I guess you're playing Edgar. And I'm the other guy. But yeah, it was pretty embarrassing. It was pretty confusing, a little nerve-wracking, but survived it.
All right, our last question was this lady here in the glasses. Can we get it to her? Well, always fun.
Well, that answer kind of led into my question. I was just wondering how you auditioned for this show, and did you know you nailed it after the audition or not?
Good question.
That's a good question.
That's a good question.
Yeah, I think you kind of innately know if you nailed an audition or not. There's just a vibe in the room when you leave. And I do remember feeling really good about the audition. And it was cool because I remember coming back in for a callback, and it was a chemistry read with Rose. And I already knew Rose beforehand because my sister and I had done a movie years ago. So when I came in, like, we hugged, we were, you know, talking, catching up, and it was just really easy to be able to play friends because we already knew each other, and it was not hard to fake that chemistry. You know, we already knew each other and had hung out a couple times. So it was great. And it's always nice when you walk out of the room and feel good about your job. It's the worst when you feel like, oh, I left a piece in there, and I want to go back in and like erase it and start from the beginning, and you can't always do that.
Yeah, you know, when I auditioned, it was on a holiday. It was on President's Day, and they apologized. It was like, we just have to have it. We know it's a holiday, and I was having a barbecue at my house that day. And so anyway, I go to the audition, and I think I was the second person who went in there, and it was like, there was a lot of, you know, and at these auditions, a lot of familiar faces and famous faces at all the auditions you go for. So I didn't really think too much about it. I was like, oh, I'm going to go in there, do my thing, and then I'm going to rush back to the barbecue. And then next thing you know, about a week and a half later, I get a call. I mean, I'm at the the gym or something. And they're like, you have to, where are you? You're supposed to be at this meeting at 9 o'clock in the morning or something like that. I'm like, I didn't know, you have to test for it. So I rushed and hustled to Hollywood.
Wait, like just that day?
That day.
Oh wow.
Literally that day. And I'm like, for what? The iZombie thing. I'm like, that was like a week and a half ago. I don't even know if I remember the lines.
Yeah.
So on the drive there, you know, I'm like going over the lines and driving like people do in LA, distracted driving. That's how people drive. It's scary. And make it there, and it's a long day. You know, you go through a process of it starts at 9 o'clock, then your day ends at 10 with studio reads, network reads. So that was that's where I met David Anders, because we went through the same process together. So you see,
were they auditioning both those roles that day?
Yeah, roles that day. So you see you see five of the Blaines, you see five of the Clives, and then you get invited to the next call back the same day. And then it's whittled down to
it's
four,
like elimination.
Then three. It's an elimination. Next thing you know, then it's you and the other guy who has an opportunity. Everybody's great. Everybody can do it. It's about what they think is going to work chemistry-wise. So, and then, you know, got the call at the end of that day. I didn't have to wait. So
that's cool.
It was exciting.
All right, that's it. Let's give a big round of applause.
Hey, thanks for the great question. Thank you, guys.
Yeah.
Thanks for the great question.
They're going to be here today.